One thing I remember when I first saw your video, Where is My Deep Mind? I think it was in Vienna. And it was maybe 2 years ago. And at the time, you know, I watched it and I was very naive because I thought a lot of it was speculative, but it wasn't. And so I was wondering, what material is the video based on? Where do you find the content? Did you find information through reading technology magazine, or were you maybe helped by an expert in machine learning? Where did you find all this information?
Okay, I'm going to try to explain you this process, which is in a way a recurring way of working for me, because I usually use this kind of first phase of accumulation of scientific materials. And as you said, they were not invented by me. I worked with the performers on this phase of translation, trying to translate this material to, let's say, body performance. And regarding the materials, the reference materials used in the film, I started a kind of collection, we could say, of scientific articles available online, mainly. Regarding machine learning and machine learning and the body. And with the article, you usually have demonstration videos explaining or showing the way the algorithm or the system is working. And so you have also like visual reference. And so it's the first part. Also, you have online on GitHub and open source many of the programs you can use by yourself, or you can experiment now with a system like Runway, which is like a framework, very easy to use. But at that time, it was not so easy. So I study a little bit of programming when I was younger. So I know a bit of Python. And so I like to experiment with this kind of stuff. So it's maybe the first part of the research, looking online, gathering the articles, and also trying to experiment with the programs. But also at that time, I was also in discussion with the team Willow at INRIA. INRIA is a French research center in computer science. And I contacted them to make a residency and a kind of partnership. It did not happen, but on the way, they gave me some references related to the project. And also during this kind of meetings with the postdocs and the researchers, I met Alexey Efros, who is, maybe you know him because he invented with other researchers this PIX2PIX program, which is in a way related to GAN. And Alexey Efros is also a professor at UC Berkeley. And at this time at Berkeley, I had an exhibition in San Francisco, so I went there and I met a researcher called Shiri Ginosa, and she's working on motion transfer, different systems that are in a way we mimic them in the film. So let's say that every encounter is like an opportunity to accumulate sources and references. And then the next phase was this translation toward the body.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, as I said, one of the first things I noticed in the work was the amount of research behind it. And the other is quite obvious, is there is a lot of humor in the video. Yeah. And in your work in general, there is a lot of humor. But I think in this case, the humor is here not just because one of the topics the video is exploring is the way machines understand jokes. So I'm wondering why this humor? Is it because the subject of machine intelligence is inherently funny because of all the absurdity of some of machine learning almost automatically entails? Or did you deliberately try to keep it light and entertaining for the audience? Because usually when we think about machine intelligence, there is a topic that tends to be a bit scary and alarming.
Yeah. You're right, because when you list the many disadvantages of AI, let's say the big word AI, many AI systems being today are, well, let's displacing, if not destroying jobs. You have this kind of bias, like the COMPASS algorithm used in the US court systems to predict the likelihood that a defendant would become a recidivist, this kind of very strong bias or example from Amazon. And well, you can make a list of this, well, the very bad carbon footprint of AI. So it's very scary. And I do not cite the, let's say, the weaponized machine learning process or, well. So the list is very sad, as you say. It's very sad. And we are living in a period when AI is still stupid, as you said, and we can still laugh about it. So it's both, I would say. In a way, it's generating many absurd movements when you look at AI and the body. But also, it's a way to take a distance. And maybe humor can be an artistic strategy to live with this sad list we have in mind. And also, I think that this kind of, let's say, ironic humor can convey ideas. And it's just like this project, Lettre de non-motivation, we talked a little bit about just before. Using humor to take a distance and to change the way we think about this could be a way not only to criticize, but to, let's say, to create a fork, to find another way to live with it or against it. Yeah.
I see. There is one other thing I wanted to say. It's towards the end of the video, there are these words that I found quite arresting, because they're explaining how humans are now helping machines to perform better. And by doing that, bit by bit, humans are ensuring that they themselves and other human beings will eventually probably become obsolete. And you have the feeling that, you know, the machines are now coming for the artists as well, because there are now machines that are used to compose music, to make films, to paint Rembrandt. So I'm going to ask you the very obvious question. Do you have this kind of fear? Is it a preoccupation for you to see artists eating up your practice? And if you're not, how do you think that artists can remain somehow relevant for the public?
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe I can give you like two answers, because first of all, if we think about the Deep Blue experiment, which is like a cliche, when Kasparov lost against the IBM computer, well, it was like maybe Terminator, this kind of crazy ideas of being replaced by the machine. But if you think about it, this experiment happened in the middle of the 90s, and we are still playing chess all around the world. So it is not because a machine is able to fly that we are not willing to fly or to play. And it's, I think it's really the same thing for art, because art, like play, is really human, and it's an eminently social activity. So it could be a first answer. And also because maybe we like to be terrified by this kind of idea of being replaced. I don't know. It's kind of very... let's say science fiction ideas. But also, when you look at it closely, it's not really what's happening. We have for a chess game, for example, we have centaurs, like players playing with the machine, but also playing against each other. And for the job market, it's a bit of a sad story, because this man-machine combination evoked at the end of the film, well, it's really something that is going to create unemployment, and because of this strange balance between at some point we have these very new systems that are very efficient, and humans are helping the system to be better and better. This is the last phrase of the film. So this is not a replacement. It's something like it's creating bad situations. I don't know. I explain it maybe not so well, but I have the feeling that it's not the machines replacing humans, but machines making humans sad, something like that. And also, if I want to answer your question about the automation of artistic tasks, maybe we can consider these intelligent machines in different ways. First of all, for artists, it could be a new, let's say, bag of tricks. We can find many tools in these new programs, maybe more positive than for the job market. And also, maybe we can also use programming as one of the fine arts. It could be also another way to use it. And maybe if we have this, let's say, Harun Faruqi approach or way of thinking, we can still criticize them and making fun of it. So, I can see different strategies that can be employed with or in front of this kind of clever parrot.
Well, that's an interesting answer, because you know this kind of question I've asked you, I've heard it asked in the context of cinema and music, where usually the person who asks the question says, oh, you know, the machines are going to make study what the public loves and make music that everybody will love, or movies that everybody will love, and so creators have no chance. And I think you give quite a more complex answer.